I will to speak about DSL and a module in Python that's called Piercer that provide some useful features for creating DSL. So if I may do a quick summary of my presentation, I must return on the correct definition of what is domain-specific modeling and what is domain-specific languages. If it's obvious, if I speak a bit about languages, I must provide a reminder about what is a compiler and how construct it, and specifically what kind of tools we could use, and precisely in Python, what kind technology we could use to create compilers. And spoiler alert, Piercer is a module that integrates all this and responds at all these problems. Okay, domain-specific modeling, it's in fact a model engineering paradigm, and its motto is each domain has its own words and relying on its own concept. If you prefer, you could say a system or a class of problems to replace if you don't understand what domain means. So the DSM methodology to try to promote the design of small language to address specific problem, because in fact we think with languages, so we need a formal representation of our thinking. So it's useful to have a correct description of what we want to do and what we want to specify. So the DSL could be a product and used in all the chain of system and software programming, because you could also produce DSL for specification of requirements, or some very specific formal language for any kind of very obscure things. So we try to avoid all human description of, for example, when you do a specification, we try to avoid all human intervention and all human description, all human text. You want to translate it in and define very specific formal language. So when we do that, words become our abstractions, and concepts become our algorithm. And we have a very high-level way of describing application or systems. And our problems is now we need complete ad hoc tools to read this description, produce code, interpret code, do something with this specification or this piece of information described in our formal language. So this kind of methodology use a lot of compilers, or need a lot of the production of a lot of compilers for specific things. In fact, oh, I'm going to. Okay. We could. We have two main way of product DSL. We have the easy way and the more complex way. The easy way is to use a host language. If our host language is expressive enough to allow us through the creation of new statements of operator overloading to implement and to represent our new abstraction, we don't need a new language. We could use our host language just to represent our abstraction. For example, Python is expressive enough to, for example, be a good candidate as host language for DSL, embedded DSL, and when we do this, we use a lot of Python classes, a lot of name parameters, a lot of operator overloading, just to represent our abstraction. But in fact, we did not need to have a new language. It's just Python with a lot of magical things. You could add a lot of metaprogrammation to hide a lot of bad stuff done in your embedded DSL. So for example, this is a piece of code of Scapy. Scapy is an embedded DSL written in Python to represent packets of networking problems and packet encapsulation. So here we have just class instantiation, name parameters, and operator overloading to represent some packets and represent the encapsulation of this packet. And in fact, it's just a factual description of the discoverer of a DHCP. So this is a runnable code, but also a specification. Okay. So when our language is expressive enough to allow what we want, here it's just enough to represent a packet, our problem is not complex enough to have or to use new operators or to use statements that are not supported by our host languages. So we need a true compiler, and we need to write a real grammar for our DSL. So just for explaining this complex stuff that is writing a compiler, just remember a few words about how to create a compiler and what is its big steps. A compiler, in fact, is three main parts. The first part is, in fact, we need to specify a grammar our new language. We need the tools to transform our grammar into a parser that could create, read our input and create an internal representation of this textual input. Traditionally, we produce something called an AST. AST stands for Abstract Syntax Tree. It's a representation of our abstraction in of our languages. It's important to understand that an AST is a real abstraction because many statements in our language, in our new languages, and is just represented in the inside of the compiler with the same AST nodes. Sometimes we think that different statements are different concepts, but in fact, it's just the same, written differently. This is the first part, and sometimes people think it is the most complicated part, but in fact, this is very, very easy now to have good production in this first part of compiler. The big and bad stuff come with the second part, when you have the internal representation of your languages. So you have the IST. To do something about it, you need to create multiple paths to identify or recognize some pattern and some form in your IST. This is for the validation of the semantics. And after that, you need to add some other paths to annotate your IST for implementing type checking and for validate the constraints attached to your semantics. And this is the real hard stuff. After that, we could continue to add some passes and transforming our IST into another form, adapted to for our interpretation or for code generation. And this is the last part of a compiler. Okay, so this. In these three steps, the first one is the most understandable and the most known part. It's basically learned in each computer science school or university. It's about to learn about grammar and typically when you have a classical computer science course about grammar, you learn about context-free grammar. Context-free grammar is the oldest and the most stable way to create grammar. The principle is to write a set of production rules. This production rule, in fact, by the tool that produces the parser, produce an automata. For this part, we need to produce this automata, so we need to avoid all ambiguities in the in this writing of production rules. And this this kind of parser is split in two main parts. The scanner that identifies some part of the input and the real automata that identifies sequences of this input, of this token. All this way of doing is have an impact of the way of how the compiler works, how the parsing works. Oui. Oui, oui, faut, je vais accélérer.
Ça marche, merci.
Ok. Okay. This part is basically static. So if we do a context-free grammar, it's really context-free. We can't adapt our parsing during parsing. So it's very, very rigid. The advantage, a subset of this technique are called parsing expression grammar, and it's just a new way of doing old stuff. So now we begin to do a scannerless parser based on top-down descent recursive parser. And with a memoization, so I don't enter in the detail, but the main interest is all rules are in fact, each rule are in fact a Boolean function. If each rule is a Boolean function, you could change the behavior of a function to add a context sensibility. So you could do some dynamic stuff. And you have another main behavior, it's a priority choice in a CFG, a classical CFG parser. All alternatives could be taken, but in PEG, you are each alternative is a test by in order. So if you fail on a rule, you could backtrack and retest some subset of your input. So you have a jungle of tools for all this stuff. You have for command CFG, you have Ply for Python, Lex and Yak, Ply Plus, LR parsing, and so on. And for the parsing expression grammar tools, in fact, all tools come from the same years. You have Arpeggio, Parsimonious, Tatsu, and Parser. Okay. A little context for why I create Parser. I need to, for with my student, to create a superset of C to include classes. So I want to provide a base, a C front end to my student, and I want they just need to inherit from this grammar and just alterate a little this grammar. So it, for me, it's better to map a grammar on classes and to map rules on methods, because it's very easy to for each. If you need to re-implement a method, to re-implement a rule, to just use inheritance to re-implement a method. Okay, so Parser is easy to install. The concept, I use inside a set of basic classes that in fact is an ADSL to parse all components of a PEG parser. And with this, I create a parser of BNF-like syntax that is finally used by the user to define his grammar. But this is just the first part of what Parser provides. The second part is a tree-handling mechanism module that allow you to do tree pattern matching on all Python data structure, and allow you to do tree rewriting. And last part is just a module to do type checking. Okay, it looks like a grammar is just a class that inherits from a grammar. You have just two class variables, grammar and entry. You have a syntax that look like a BNF. And you have classical repeaters like stars, plus, and question mark. You have special things like that look like decorators that in fact are directive, but it's like decorator on rules. So you could alterate your rules, and this stuff is used to handle commands, white spaces, and things like that. You have a lot of symbol to create your grammar. You have things to read literal. You have things to manage alternative, all the look ahead, positive or negative, complement, and things like that. So grammar is a class, rule is a method. So all is overridable, and you could do something called grammar composition. So you could create a form of first grammar, another grammar, and mix up with a third grammar. For handling IST, I rely on just two concepts, nodes and hooks. Nodes for data handling and hooks for event handling. The main idea is just to separate the Python code from the description, the grammar description. You just need to say that you capture with the colon operator, that you capture something returned by a rule, and connect it with a hook. A hook is just a callback on a Python function. And okay, and that's all. J'ai avancé parce que. And so a hook is just a Python function. It's a method on the grammar. So you have your instance parser of your parser. So you could do ugly stuff, but you receive also your nodes. So you could create things on it. And each hook, in fact, is also a rule. So it's a Boolean function. So hooks need to return true. But if you want, if you need, you could return false for forcing the backtracking of your parser. For example, if you manage a symbol table for C parser, you have the benefits of this. If you want to create an XML parser, you could match the closing tag of opening tag just by setting it's not the same value, so I return false, and so the parser backtrack on the correct rules. I have produced a more complete example of this tool. On the parser documentation, you have a JSON parser, a step-by-step creation of a JSON parser to understand all the basic stuff of parser. And you have the complete C front-end that I provide to my student in this link. After that, you have also the equivalent of regex for trees, that is called SPSL. The basic principle is you provide a pattern with a special syntax, another DSL, to identify Python data structure and to say what we do with it. For example, here I decide to capture all the types A, whatever the attributes, and to call a hook. And this pattern of code match the tree with the compiled patterns, and call the hook if we found our object. And with parser selector language, you could match types, kind of types, value or any value attributes, list based on the index or at any index. Same thing for the dictionary. You could validate sequence of ancestors of sequence of siblings. And all combination of that. So you could describe a subpart of trees and run it on UIST and quite easily detect bad construction or good construction, or you could also create a tree of tree or writing, because the main algorithm is bottom up. So you begin to rewrite your tree from the deepest part and you remount to the roots. And the last part, you have also a type system, but the main projects of the project that I do with my student is near C++. So the type system is oriented for ad hoc polymorphism. So not a type reconstruction yet, but it's in progress. I have produced also another tutorial to explain how to connect UAST to the inference type checking to do magic stuff. And this is all the functional parts of parser, but parser continue to evolve. The main project evolve in Coop++, so we add some bad features, special features, complex features. So I have, for example, need a better type system. It's in progress. And another part, I extract from my PSL module the embedded DSL of the matching engine for trees into an agnostic version that's called tree matching, and it's work in progress, but it's an agnostic Python module for any data structure in Python. So if you want to match something, but you need to write it as an embedded DSL, so you need to instantiate all that Python classes to write patterns, so it's a little boring. But if you need it, why not?